Before I give the floor to my colleague Anki Eriksson, the Deputy Director of the New York Liaison Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, I would like to thank all those who made this event possible. There are a couple of developments that led to this event. The first one is a small book, which is back there, is a little bit over 1,100 pages, and it is the product of a three-year study done under the supervision of Katja and Anna and Nigel. Two of them are here with us today, and we're very pleased. Unfortunately, Nigel could not be with us today, the third actually author of this study. The second thing, of course, is the ongoing debate within the United Nations about reform and changing the counter-terrorist architecture of the organization. So we very much hope a lot of the discussion that we are having today, some of the findings, as well some of the thoughts and views, will somehow have some kind of a contribution to this ongoing debate, which is a very important debate on a vital world order issue. I would also like to acknowledge the co-sponsorship of this event by the Center on Terrorism here at John Jay. I would like to thank all the participants that agreed to be with on this panel, and they will be introduced by our chair. And I would also like to acknowledge the contribution of two entities that made this event possible, the Venable Foundation and Oxford University Press. So without further ado, I now give the floor to Anki Eriksson, who will moderate the panel as well as the discussion to follow. Thank you.
Thank you very much, George. From my side as well, warmly welcome to this panel discussion, jointly organized by the Center for International Human Rights at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, as well as the UN Counterterrorism Implementation Task Force Working Group on Protecting Human Rights While Countering Terrorism. It's a very long title. I apologize for that. And as George already said, the theme for today is UN reform, the rule of law, and counterterrorism. How can past lessons inform future responses? Before handing over to the panel, though, I would like to give you a little bit of background to today's discussion. On 25th of January this year, the UN Secretary General presented his five-year action agenda to the UN Assembly, General Assembly. And in this action agenda, he identified five key priorities. And three of these five are related to rule of law and counterterrorism concerns. And that is building a safer and more secure world, which includes standing strong on fundamental principles of democracy and human rights, the need to prevent human rights abuses, and supporting nations in transition. So today's panel will identify and explore what I believe to be some of the most important substantive, institutional, and procedural aspects of this reform agenda relevant to the UN's responses to terrorism threats. It will include discussions on the substance and parameters of applicable international rule of law framework and pivotal concepts, such as security, prevention, and protection, including making recommendation as to how the existing framework might be strengthened in practice. Although the current UN reform agenda constitutes a prism through which these rule of law and counterterrorist matters will be considered, many of the issues raised will be of wider applicability and a wider interest as well. In addition to the reform or action agenda, the Secretary General to the UN just recently released the report on the UN Global Counterterrorism Strategy, activities of the UN system in implementing the strategy. And this review will be a report will be reviewed now in June. And the discussion is also brought into a number of side events. So a lot of discussions are being now on the agenda these last couple of months and forthcoming months as well. Just to mention, just last week, the Security Council debated threats to peace and security caused by terrorist acts, strengthening international cooperation and implementation of counter-terrorist obligation. And this was under the Azerbaijani presidency. So let's go back to our panel discussion. Much of the discussion, though, here will be centering around the relevant findings and recommendations of the three-year multinational, multidisciplinary collaborative research project that George mentioned. And now when I'm turning to introducing the panel very briefly, since I'm sure you've already picked up the bios at the back of the room. I'll start with the two co-editors of the book. We have Katja Samuel, who is, in addition to being the co-editor to the book, she's also a project co-director and works at the Nottingham University in UK. And we have Anna María Salinas de Frías, also of course book editor and professor of public international law at Málaga University in Spain. Then we have someone who I don't think needs a lot of introduction, George Andreopoulos, professor of political science and director of the Center for International Human Rights here. And we have E.J. Flynn, senior human rights officer, UN Counterterrorism Committee, Executive Directorate. And then we have Marit Kohonen-Sheriff, Deputy Director for OHCHR here in New York since Monday. Yeah. And she's here representing not only OHCHR, but also the CTITF Working Group on Protection of Human Rights While Countering Terrorism. So without further ado, I'd like to hand over first to Katja, who will take a few minutes to briefly introduce the project to you. And Anna will outline some parts of the UN Secretary General's reform agenda priorities. And I'll hand over first to Katja, and then I know Anna will take over when you will co-jointly speak. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And first of all, may I add my thanks to those of the chair for finding times in your busy schedule to join us this evening. And would also like to convey my own thanks to George and his colleagues and to our co-sponsors for making today's event possible. As Anki has mentioned, the discussion of the panel today is based around this recently published tome, which it feels like a paving stone carrying around in my bag, on counterterrorism international law and practice. And the project was conceived in 2008 to examine what does the rule of law mean in the specific context of counterterrorism. Because there's many key concepts which underpin counterterrorist responses, others of which we'll touch on briefly today, such as the concept of prevention, which are absolutely pivotal in counterterrorism responses, but for which there isn't always universal agreement as to their exact definition and their parameters. And a key focus of the project as well was not only to identify what is the international framework applicable to counterterrorism responses, but where are the gaps, where are the weaknesses, and how might it be strengthened? And as such, the project is aimed at the governmental and the intergovernmental audience, primarily including practitioners and policymakers, and it's aimed to be solution orientated. So many recommendations are made within the book as well in the terms of identification of best practices and how some of the current gaps and weaknesses might be addressed. The overarching theme of the project as well, it starts with the premise that governments have legitimate security imperatives to address, and that often they are complex, they're very real, and indeed that one of the primary human rights obligations upon any state is to protect those residing within its territory. And we examine how may they be accommodated within the existing rule of law framework, not least because there's already inbuilt exceptionality, for example, derogations under human rights law, humanitarian law of its very nature is exceptional. And we resist the language of balancing the rule of law against security imperatives, not least because that can introduce a slippery slope of exceptionality, which, to use the phrase of the International Commission of Jurists, can become the normalisation of the exceptional, whereby what should be the exception for the minimum time absolutely necessary becomes the norm. In terms of the collaboration, we're an independent project made up with many different expertise. And we were very careful in our selection of experts to represent all major regions of the world, as well as the key disciplines, both legal and non-legal, involved in counter-terrorism responses, not least such that our findings and recommendations might be legitimate across the world. And as such, we would suggest that the methodology that we've employed, the voices who are represented, many of them very senior and true experts on their field, is a project of global relevance and application. And in fact, within the book, we draw upon the expertise of about 40 of those experts. I'm now going to hand over to Anna, who is going to introduce in a little bit more detail the UN reform agenda, and in particular the way that the panel discussion is being framed tonight is to show how timely and relevant it is to the current political agenda, including within the UN, not only on reform matters but also in the context of the forthcoming biennial review of the counter-terrorism strategy.
Good evening already. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And let me thank you first of all for the opportunity of taking part in this panel and sharing discussions and exchanges of views with all of you. And in particular, let me thank to Professor Andreopoulos and to the Center for International Human Rights at John Jay College of Criminal Justice and all those who made possible this panel today. As has been just said by the chairperson of this panel, in January 2012, the United Nations Secretary General presented his five-year action agenda to the UN General Assembly, in which he identified five key priorities, one of which is of particular relevance to counterterrorism, namely, and has been said already, building a safer and more secure world, which includes standing strong on fundamental principles of democracy and human rights. Another priority has importance for terrorism-related matters, also the need to prevent human rights abuses which can occur and have occurred in the context of state responses to terrorism-related security imperatives. Much of the current focus is on reforming and strengthening the UN institutional architecture and mechanisms, including to enhance coherence and scale up United Nations counterterrorism efforts, such as through the creation of a single UN counterterrorism coordinator. These are without doubt of great importance, and every effort should be made to achieve them. Nevertheless, it is suggested here that the hoped for benefits of reform, not least from a rule of law and counterterrorism perspective, are unlikely to deliver their intended outcomes unless corresponding weight and attention is given to developing and strengthening related substantive norms. Even if well-developed mechanisms exist, they are unlikely to fulfill their true potential if the substantive elements are unclear or underdeveloped. The UN has a unique role to play here as a global setter of international recognized standards and norms. Furthermore, an integral element of the notion of the rule of law is that its applicable laws must ensure predictability and certainty, not least to have a power restraining effect to prevent excesses and abuses by executives and agents of both states and international organizations. Indeed, a common denominator detected amongst root cases of terrorism is no accountable government and no rule of law. There is universal agreement regarding the importance of the rule of law. There is, however, no corresponding universally agreed definition of the concept of the rule of law, whether generally or in the specific context of counterterrorism. Therefore, universal rule of law principles generally identify apply also to counterterrorist policies and responses. Very briefly, that first, a government and its officials and agents are accountable under the law. Second, the laws are clear, publicized, testable, and fair, and protect fundamental rights. Third, the process by which the laws are enacted, administered, and enforced is accessible, fair, and efficient. And fourth, access to justice is provided by competent, independent, and ethical adjudicators, attorneys, or representative and judicial officers who are of sufficient number, have adequate resources, and reflect the makeup of the communities they serve. In the specific context of counterterrorism, the correct starting point is believed to be the United Nations Global Counterterrorism Strategy 2006. The pivotal importance of the rule of law both underpins and is reiterated throughout its text, in particular in Pillar 4, and the legal principles it includes: international human rights law, international humanitarian law, asylum immigration law, and international criminal law, and of course the United Nations Charter. These sources of legal principles do not operate in isolation. Instead, they are increasingly interrelated and interconnected. But other important underpinning general principles here are also those of equality and non-discrimination. One of the most important aspects of the concept of equality and non-discrimination is right to equality before the courts. Although it may technically be lawful and legitimate to lower some of these standards for terrorism-related cases in limited circumstances, in practice, any special criminal procedures often undermine basic human rights protections, including the ordinary due process guarantees of a criminal trial, or permit excessive and disproportionate criminal sanctions, and therefore should be avoided. The importance of security to both states and the UN system is fully recognized. This means that the value of security and its inherent imperatives may be incorporated into the international rule of law framework where this is not already the case. Particular terrorist threats or activities are so serious that they may be considered to constitute a public emergency which threatens the life of the nation. This enables the executive to respond to such security imperatives by temporarily and proportionality adjusting its legal system to provide increased security and to decrease the protection of non-durable rights and freedoms for as long as the exigencies of the situation require this. However, such exceptional measures should always comply with the principles of legality, necessity, and proportionality. The scope of the examination of rule of law principles in operation is important also. Although much of the focus has traditionally been on individuals, and state actors, or including increasingly non-state actors, the scope needs to be broadened to consider also international organizations. There is an increasing expectation that such organizations will themselves be models in terms of reflecting and adhering to such standards and principles within their own institutional responses. This is reflective of wider discourse and trends towards ensuring greater accountability and closing existing or potential impunity gaps at every level. Therefore, while the UN has a pivotal role to play in terms of overseeing compliance with the rule of law at the national and international levels, it is imperative that it both fully recognizes and reflects its own institutional responsibilities and commitments in this regard. Other principles of general international law to be taken into account are those governing the direct or indirect responsibility of states and international organizations for internationally wrongful acts or omissions, whether they are conducted throughout state institutional agents or throughout private actors. Finally, although these bodies of principles and their related institutions and mechanisms are generally well established, nevertheless, an important underlying tension remains that most of them were not developed specifically to respond to terrorism and counterterrorism. Therefore, tensions and sometimes uncertainty exist regarding the exact manner in which particular norms should be interpreted and applied in these specific contexts. While it would appear that a corpus of counterterrorism law is emerging, this is considered to be still in its relative infancy and not to be sufficiently well defined or developed to be treated as a coherent, self-contained international anti-terrorism legal regime. If the UN agenda reform is to meet the Secretary General's identified priorities relating to security, both the substantive and procedural institutional aspects of the UN architecture relevant for counterterrorism must be afforded equal importance, as well as be examined and progressed in parallel. The scope must focus equally on individuals, non-state actors, states, and international organizations. The scope of the substantive rule of law norms applicable to a counterterrorism context should also incorporate international humanitarian law, international domestic criminal law, and international refugee law, not least in order to be consistent with the UN global counterterrorism strategy. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. As Anna has outlined, at the core of the Secretary General's reform agenda lies the concept of prevention and the need to adopt and strengthen existing preventive approaches. Certainly for counterterrorism to be effective, it needs to have a strong preventive element, the ultimate aim being to stop an attack long before it's launched. Despite the pivotal role and significance of this concept, however, as with some other core concepts, including the rule of law itself, it too suffers from having no universally agreed definition or scope. Consequently, state and UN preventive responses may take many different forms, some of which I'll briefly outline now, noting a few corresponding areas of rule of law concern and constraint. And just to say that our report has been made available for you. There's copies of an executive summary at the back. And if you would like the full copy of the report, that will be available, that gives more details of the preventive responses and all of the recommendations. One going to look at is non-forcible and forcible responses under the UN Charter. Clearly, the UN Charter itself has got a strong preventive element, including under Chapter 7, reflected in Article 39, Threat to the Peace, which permits both non-forcible and forcible measures, for example, under Article 41, which generally takes the form of sanctions against state individuals or non-state actors, or forcible under Article 42 in response to threats or breaches of the peace. clearly there's been much concern regarding the sanctions regimes, both against states and against individuals. With reference to states, even where the sanctions are targeted in nature, they can have profound economic, social, political, and other human rights implications upon a whole population. Similarly, financial sanctions imposed against individuals can significantly impact upon their lives, and concerns remain regarding adequate levels of due process, not least the review mechanisms in place for the imposition of such sanction regimes. And that's something that George will discuss in more detail. Another is anti-terrorism legislation, where the development, implementation, and enforcement of effective and rule of law compliant anti-terrorist legislation systems from the domestic to the international levels are clearly critical, not least in underpinning the UN counter-terrorism strategy, where criminal justice responses should be the norm and armed conflict stroke military approaches should be exceptional. Indeed, one might say that effective preventive measures within a criminal justice approach could largely avoid the necessity for military approaches. As such, robust and effective criminal justice systems may also be preventive in the sense of sending out strong deterrent messages to would-be terrorists. An important constraint, clearly, is the absence of a universal definition of terrorism, not least for the purpose of developing more consistent and coherent national approaches to anti-terrorism legislation and strengthening interstate cooperation. That said, even if a universal definition of terrorism is ever reached, it will not be the panacea for addressing all existing challenges and weaknesses. Ultimately, the effect of any criminal justice framework is dependent upon the existence of the requisite levels of political and institutional will to effectively implement and enforce them. Other concerns include substantive ones, for example, poorly drafted legislation, which can be ambiguous, overbroad, vulnerable to politicisation, and may offend fundamental human rights principles, not least the principle of legality. There are procedural concerns as well, namely the need to afford suspected terrorists adequate levels of due process and other safeguards that should be an inherent part of any criminal justice approach. A third example is administrative detention or internment, which has become certainly more common as a tool of prevention since 2001. This involves the deprivation of liberty for purposes similar to those of criminal law, namely the removal of a person perceived to pose a threat to society and or to obtain information without the discipline and the safeguard of the criminal justice process and the involvement of the judiciary. Technically, as far as the jurisprudence is at the moment, so long as states derogate from their Article 9 International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights obligations regarding arbitrary detention, such practices have not yet been authoritatively held to be unlawful, so far as derogation is valid and remains proportionate. Administrative internment is permissible to during armed conflict situations until such time as hostilities cease. However, there are many rule of law concerns relating to such practices. Briefly mention some. One has been the practice of distinguishing between nationals and non-nationals of particular states, which offended principles of equality and non-discrimination. Another has been the potential for different forms of mistreatment of detainees, whether or not in the context of interrogation and intelligence gathering. There have been inadequate levels of due process, such as detention review mechanisms. Uncertainties regarding the exact interpretation and application of existing rules to transnational conflicts, which were not envisaged at the time of the drafting of the rules, is posing a number of challenges. And that detention might become indefinite, whether due to the principle of non-refoulement, which prohibits the return of individuals to a country where there's a significant risk of their mistreatment or even death, or due to unhelpful political rhetoric, whether the previous war against terror or now even the war against Al-Qaeda, which is without temporal or geographical limits, sometimes making it difficult to discern when a particular armed conflict has ended, such that detainees should be released. Another concerns intelligence and evidence gathering. Clearly, the intelligence community and law enforcement officials perform central preventive functions, with intelligence services seeking to intercept and prevent future terrorist attacks through effective intelligence gathering and the collection by law enforcement agencies of evidence necessary to prosecute suspected terrorists to prevent the prevention of both future terrorist activities by the persons concerned, as well as sending out a strong deterrent message. In terms of constraint, during any questioning or interrogation of suspected terrorists, it's essential that violence, oppression, or threats are never used to gain admissions from suspects. Such practices are never legally, legitimately, or morally defensible, even when responding to significant and legitimate security imperatives. Another particular source of concern has been the blurring of traditional functions between the intelligence community and law enforcement agencies, whereby the former have become involved in such activities as arresting, detaining, or questioning terrorist suspects, normally without adequate training or comprehension of criminal justice processes. Consequently, not only have human rights violations resulted, for example, arbitrary arrest and mistreatment in detention, but potentially evidence necessary for prosecuting suspected terrorists has become contaminated in the process, rendered inadmissible, and in fact thereby actually undermining the preventive benefits of effective criminal justice processes. Another practice has been targeted killings, namely the use of lethal force against suspected terrorists. It may be permissible for governments to neutralise what may be a very real threat to the lives of their own citizens and territory, especially where persons concerned are in the territory of another country that is either unwilling to constrain their activities or incapable of doing so, so long as it is a measure of absolute last resort to prevent future terrorist attacks, and where express or implied consent by the host state for intervention is given. Of course, there are many rule of law concerns here also. First, under law enforcement criminal justice regime, it would appear the governing law is that international human rights, underpinned by a growing presumption that states may not commit acts abroad that would be unlawful at home. The conventional view is that any premeditated use of lethal force can never be non-arbitrary or absolutely necessary. The hidden assumption being that unless the threat to life of others is imminent, there will always be other means of frustrating the threat that have to be considered and preferred to the use of lethal force. Consequently, the position currently would appear to be that lethal force may exceptionally be used by law enforcement officials when trying to effect an arrest, subject to the strict criteria I've briefly mentioned. Even in a situation of armed conflict, it may be permissible to use lethal force against privileged or de facto combatants. However, even here, lethal force should not be used unless there's military necessity for doing so. The final practice I'm going to briefly mention is the use, and in some cases misuse, of asylum and refugee law as a preventive instrument of governments to deny asylum and to physically remove from their territory those determined as terrorists. Technically, expulsion is possible under the Refugee Convention 1951, where certain criteria are met, including under Article 33.2, which is designed to protect national security interests of the country of refuge, and Article 1F of the Refugee Convention. In terms of constraint and concerns, the use of the immigration system as an instrument of prevention raises many rule of law concerns. For example, their effectiveness. Typically, expulsions merely enable those suspected of terrorist defence of acts to join or rejoin terrorist networks overseas, or violations of the principle of non-refoulement, which is a norm of customary international law with jus cogens status and ergo omnes obligations of the international community, cannot be reduced or balanced against security imperatives. Although some sending states seek diplomatic assurances from receiving states, significant concerns exist, including their exact legal status and their effectiveness in practice. Nor do those removed on the basis of suspicion of criminal wrongdoing generally benefit from the safeguards of a criminal justice process, including the requirements of fairness and due process. So just a few concluding remarks. As is evident from a very quick overview, the concept of prevention can be somewhat elastic in terms of how it's reflected within state practices especially, with resultant strains often being placed upon the international rule of law framework governing counter-terrorist responses. Consequently, we'd like to make three brief recommendations in relation to the UN reform agenda. There are many more within the report. First is that much of the discourse is centred around the procedural, mechanistic aspects of the UN's architecture for responding to counter-terrorism. I would suggest that unless equal and parallel attention is given to the substantive aspects of that architecture, the reform agenda will not realise its full potential of its stated goals. The second is that much of the rule of law focus, and rightly so, is upon human rights issues, which of course are of paramount importance, not least reflected within the co-sponsorship of this event. However, in the context of possibly an emerging corpus of counter-terrorism law, if a truly robust integrated rule of law framework is to be developed, it's important that in addition to the existing work on human rights, not alternatively, but in addition, that further attention is given to the other principles specifically articulated, not only within the UN counter-terrorism strategy, but the many other principles that Anna gave a brief outline as well. And we suggest that now is a critical and pivotal time as this framework is developing to truly influence the norms, the development, the implementation of a very robust framework for the future. And the final comment is that as the principal lawmaker and standard-setting organ of the UN, the General Assembly should be encouraged to do much more in terms of bringing greater clarity and cohesion to those core concepts underpinning counter-terrorism responses, not least the concept of prevention, including in terms of further defining their related norms and defining parameters of legality and illegality. This would assist also in strengthening the international rule of law framework, both normatively as well as in practice. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Katja and Anna. And now we'll turn to George, who will give some comments on the concepts of legitimacy and accountability.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I would like to begin by something that's in the executive summary and also was highlighted by Katja's remarks, the concluding remarks, and especially the first one, that it is very important if this agenda, the reform agenda, is to move forward, that the relationship between the substantive and institutional architecture must be based on an understanding that it is mutually reinforcing. And that even if well-developed mechanisms exist, they are unlikely to fulfill their true potential. Not least in terms of being effective and perceived as legitimate if the substantive elements are unclear and undeveloped. And I think that my brief comments will be a plea basically for the greatest clarity of the substantive elements in the reform agenda. And although I agree with the authors of this report that when we talk about the substantive corpus, we are not talking about human rights law, but humanitarian law, refugee law, domestic and international criminal law, most of my comments will focus on the context of human rights law, but the other bodies of law are clearly relevant. I will also say something at the end about the suggestion that if this agenda is to move forward, must be primarily and internally as opposed to externally driven. A few comments about legitimacy. The way I understand legitimacy, which is a very important attribute of power, is that legitimacy is what gives power a social purpose, a legitimate social purpose. That's what distinguishes power from authority. And the quest here is to move away from power and towards authority in the United Nations actions, something which for which actually we saw a very serious deficit in the early phases of the counter-terrorist agenda, in particular, of course, in the context of the Security Council, which hijacked, shall I say, the counter-terrorist agenda very early on in a rather muscular way. A couple of attributes of legitimacy, a couple of mechanisms to enhance legitimacy, although these are not the only ones, are the issue of consensus and the issue of precedent. Precedent is very important in legal argumentation, but not only in legal argumentation, also in political argumentation, because it forces those that want to advance a particular agenda to make sure that it is done in a coherent, a consistent way. You have to treat similar cases alike. Any divergences have to be explained. There must be an internal coherence in the argument. And consensus, I would argue, is formed by what we consider the relevant normative framework. What are the values that we agree on that form the grammar, our vocabulary, our common discourse on how we try to address these issues? And of course, one of the things that we noticed very early on is that there was some kind of a deficit in the Security Council approach to these issues. If you look, first of all, on the issue of, if you look at precedent, they appeal to previous counter-terrorist resolutions, and they also appeal to the fact that there is a changing understanding of what constitutes a threat to international peace and security. But out of the discourse was left the Security Council's interesting record during the 90s, increasingly looking at human rights and humanitarian law violations as threats to international peace and security. That was left a little bit out of the discourse. When you look at the issue actually of consensus, what was the normative consensus around which the discussion was supposed to start? At that time, the 12 counter-terrorist treaties were to form the framework. Well, one of the most prominent treaties highlighted in Resolution 1373 was the Treaty on the Financing of Terrorism. Interestingly enough, however, how was that treated within the resolution? The enforcement provisions were selected, but the human rights provisions were left out. So we had some kind of what you might say an a la carte interpretation of what should be the consensus around which our counter-terrorist policies will be framed. And of course, the battle was set for what was to follow, and the effort has been there since, an uphill struggle on how can we try to mainstream human rights concerns in the work of the Security Council. When it comes to the 1373 process, my colleague Ed will say more, although I'm not sure whether he will use that military battlefield analogy, you know, manning the battle lines there of human rights within the Security Council. I would like to turn my attentions, bearing in mind these very, of course, preliminary remarks, on the role of the Security Council, in particular when it comes to the Sanctions Committee, but this also underscores its action under the 1373 resolution, because it has raised critical questions as to, for example, what law binds the United Nations Security Council when it acts under Chapter 7? And in addition, if states act in accordance with their obligation under the Charter, and this conflicts with their obligations under Human Rights Treaty, who is responsible for the human rights violations that may result? And some of these issues have been raised in the context, of course, of the 1267 Sanctions Committee and several cases that have come before it. And just let me remind you from the very, I don't have time, of course, to go to all the details about the performance of the Sanctions Committee, but the very beginning, when you were put on the list, you didn't even know that you were on the list. You didn't have any right to access any information. There wasn't any communication with any mechanism, individual or collective mechanism, within the Security Council, and so on and so forth. In fact, one of the cases, the only way that you could appeal to your listing is by asking your country of residence or nationality to inquire with the committee as to the grounds for your listing on that committee. And in fact, this was one of the reasons why one of the individuals that is associated with one of the most famous cases that have gone before the European Court of Human Rights, the Qaida case, one of the reasons that he turned actually to these organs is because originally the country of whose national he was, Saudi Arabia, refused to submit his request to the 1260 section, 1267 Sanctions Committee. Now, interestingly enough, and again at the risk of a little bit of overgeneralization, when these cases went before the regional courts, especially the European Court of First Instance, now General Court, and eventually the European Court of Justice, you saw a little bit to a couple of different approaches. Initially, the lower court says that the review should be very restricted because what we have hanging over our head was a Security Council resolution, and you really didn't want to take that head on. When it went, however, the case in the European Court of Justice, the court actually ruled that you can review the regulation of the European Council that implements the sanction, but not the Security Council resolution itself. And of course, this raises some interesting question about are we developing a parallel legal order within the European Union framework, and what will be thus the repercussion about the status of public international law within the European legal order? And of course, some analysts expressed some concern about that development. The counter-argument, however, was that although they are doing it in a rather timid way initially and a little bit more forceful as more cases started coming before them, that was a necessary way to deal simply because there was not adequate review mechanism within the United Nations system. So other mechanisms had to step in to fill the void, and hopefully put some pressure in the United Nations system, together, of course, with the other voices that were being heard at that time, as, for example, from the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, of course, Marit will speak more about that, the Special Rapporteur on the Promotion and Protection of Human Rights, while countering terrorists that were pointing out to the human rights deficit on all these processes. And now we have actually a case that is pending before the European Court of Human Rights, Nada versus Switzerland, which I think it will be interesting to see what the court says, because I will tell you what I hope will address, but I'm not sure whether it will do so. Which relates, of course, to a listing that occurred under 1267 and Swiss Federal Council regulation implementing this kind of listing. The question that I personally would like to see the court addressing before it goes to the question whether the obligations under the Charter trump obligation under human rights, to check what kind of resolutions does the United Nations Security Council with this resolution validly creates the obligations that it seeks to enforce. Before we go to the question of the tension between Article 103 and obligations under human rights treaties, because that will raise the rather interesting question as far as I'm concerned. You know, are there any restrictions on the actions of the Security Council when it tries to trample on certain fundamental due process rights? Should be thinking in terms of different resolutions that take more seriously into account of that? And if some violation result, what is the responsibility of the United Nations Security Council in the process? Now, of course, I don't know if all these are going to come up in that case, or maybe the ruminations of an academic, but it will be interesting to see. I will also say that in addition to the European Court of Human Rights, we should also highlight here the important contribution of some monitoring organs of human rights treaties, primarily the Human Rights Committee, which has tackled cases, primarily have in mind the Sayadi and Vink case versus Belgium here. Which again found in the end that this, you know, the facts in the end disclosed a violation of Article 12 as well as a violation of Article 17 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. Now, what is the result of all these things? Clearly, we have we are not here today where we were back to when this discussion started. And as a result, I would argue, of this pressure that some of these regional courts, the human rights bodies, the treaty organs, as well as non-governmental organizations that jumped into the debate very early on and produced some very powerful report criticized some of these practices, we have had some changes within the system. But still, although we have moved away from power and towards authority, we still have a long way to go towards authority, if authority, of course, means exercising your power with a legitimate social purpose. I think still there is quite a substantial deficit that will need to be addressed. And here, I would say that one of the things that I hope will inform this discussion as we try to get into the trickier aspects of this debate, in the extent to which non-compliance with derogable rights may lead to violation of non-derogable rights. That is one of the things that I think all this discussion, but not only within the 1267 committee, but broadly with other policies and practices of the Security Council, has demonstrated in the increasing interconnectedness between derogable and non-derogable rights. And I hope that this will be something that will inform this discussion and the action as we move forward. There is much more I would like to say, but I don't want to get Anki upset here. So I would like to briefly conclude with the following, that bearing in mind that we are not here today where we started and have changes have occurred even within, and if of course Kim Prost would have been here with us today, I hope you have elaborated a little bit of some of the developments and the contribution of the Office of the Ombudsperson, who is one of the most recent contributions to this evolving attempt to become a little bit more due process sensitive, which was established, as you know, in 2009. I would say that clearly we must pay more attention to the substantive aspects of the counterterrorism architecture. Second, we cannot understand the achievements, whatever they are, that we have reached up to this point without looking at the interconnectedness of processes that occur within the United Nations system as well as outside the United Nations system, that the growing cross-fertilizations of processes that are initiated in regional courts, in basically the work of non-governmental organizations, and so on and so forth, together, and to what extent they reinforce efforts within the United Nations system to move forward to a more rule of law sensitive agenda on this issue. Third, I would say that the counter-terrorism strategy of the General Assembly provides some very important spaces in which this interaction between the UN bodies and non-UN bodies can deepen, become more dense, and make the cross-fertilization more meaningfully. And these spaces should be exploited to the fullest. And of course, in this context, it is the equal responsibility of UN organs as well as non-UN organs to work in tandem with this effort. And I think the counter-terrorism agenda and the different spaces and the proliferation of issues on the agenda, whether you are talking about rehabilitation programs, the discussion about issues conducive to terrorism, issues of incitement, that big broader human rights issues, are offering important opportunities for a greater discussion and interaction and cross-fertilization. And finally, which of course I think follows from what I just said, I think we should be thinking less about internal as opposed to externally driven reform agenda, as to what extent, rather we should be thinking in terms as to what extent internal developments and external development can find productive convergences to move forward to a more rule of law sensitive agenda. So with this, I stop.
Thank you very much, George, and also for trying to stick within the time frame.
Did I? I hope.
But a couple of minutes over.
Okay.
Let me now then hand over to EJ, who will examine the strategic approach taken by the Security Council to terrorism threats.
Thank you very much, Anki, and I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation to attend this event. Thanks to all of you for joining us this evening. I'd like to recognize in particular the valuable partnership that I at CTED and we at the Security Council have established with the Center for International Human Rights and Professor Andreopoulos over these last few years. We've gotten great insight from George's analysis of issues we're discussing today. And I'd also like to commend Katja and Anna, and in his absence, Professor Nigel White for the phenomenal accomplishment of putting together this this major tome with so many useful essays on different aspects of rule of law and counterterrorism. I'm going to address, I think my remarks will build very well on what the previous speakers have covered. I'm going to address the question of United Nations reform and the rule of law in the Security Council's work on counterterrorism. And there have been important developments, I think, including with respect to some of the issues that George has just put on the table, the contrast between power and legitimate authority, the cross-fertilization between Security Council processes, General Assembly processes, and for that matter, processes of other entities both within and outside the UN system, including the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. And I think that there's been some major evolution, an important evolution, and I think it bodes well for United Nations reform. My ultimate message is going to be one of optimism, but I work as a human rights officer, so we're always optimists, rather hopeless optimists when it comes down to it. Just to summarize quickly, as many of you know, the Security Council took action after 9/11. It adopted this resolution 1373 under Chapter 7. It's a sharp-edged resolution. It was considered historic in the sense that it imposed legal obligations on all states in the world, and not just, let's say, on states that were involved in a particular conflict or other focused threat to international peace and security, but it legislated for every single country in the world. And as George said, it took rather an a la carte approach to some of the norms that had existed previously, including the International Convention on Terrorist Financing. It did not include in its provisions the human rights elements of the International Convention, which, by the way, does require states party to treat individuals with fair treatment, to provide fair treatment to those who are the subject of measures under that convention. No, 1373 scarcely mentions human rights at all, and the argument was made in the days and months and years just after 9/11 that as a Chapter 7 resolution, it essentially, to an extent, trumped human rights obligations of states, maybe not to the extent of permitting violation of Jus Cogens norms, but generally that as a Chapter 7 resolution, it took precedence over states' human rights obligations. I would argue that shouldn't be the case for resolutions adopted by the Security Council. I think that there are clear provisions in the Charter which say that Security Council action should be in conformity with human rights, and that one of the fundamental purposes and principles of the organization, which the Security Council is bound to respect, is to bring about, in conformity with the principles of justice and international law, the adjustment or settlement of international situations that might lead to a breach of the peace, and also, of course, to achieve international cooperation in promoting and encouraging respect for human rights. But nonetheless, there was a great doubt in the years after the adoption of this resolution about its impact on human rights. Obviously, there was a lot of there was global support for the international effort to take strong action against terrorism, but there began to be growing calls to re-examine how human rights was integrated into this effort. And the special rapporteur, the first special rapporteur on protecting human rights while countering terrorism, Professor Martin Scheinen of Finland, noted that some of the questions that the Counterterrorism Committee, which I work for, which monitors implementation of 1373, that some of the questions it was putting to states seemed to imply that human rights was not a concern. For example, the committee was asking states what measures have they put in place, what special investigative techniques are they using to identify and root out terrorism, and there was no reflection whatsoever of the need to respect basic rule of law principles in that question. But indeed, this did all begin to change. It's changed remarkably, and I think today the extent of the change is really phenomenal. But it's been slow in coming. It took a couple of years, or about a year and a half after the adoption of Resolution 1373, for the Security Council to adopt another global resolution on counterterrorism generally, Resolution 1456, which does contain a provision stating that states must ensure that measures they take to counterterrorism comply with their human rights, refugee law, and humanitarian law obligations. And this change was really the result of external advocacy that was referred to. It showed that the Security Council and the UN, as many as we all know, but sometimes we're not so sure about the Security Council, it is amenable to pressure from different sectors. The Office of the High Commissioner, and particularly the High Commissioner at that time, Mary Robinson, who wrote the preface to Anna and Katja's book, was one of the leaders of this this campaign to change the way the Security Council did things, NGOs, some member states. And so things came around, and when they finally created, when the Security Council, by Resolution 1535, created the supportive mechanism that I'm a part of, which we call CTED, the Counterterrorism Executive Directorate, when it created CTED, the council members agreed that CTED should take account of human rights to a certain extent. There was one staff position created to handle that brief. We're about 40 altogether, including 25 legal officers. But that was a step in the right direction, and under the leadership of the then chair of the Counterterrorism Committee, Denmark, we made great progress toward integrating human rights into our interaction with states. So the situation that the Special Rapporteur had called attention to of totally ignoring human rights in dialogue with states pretty much ended with the creation of CTED, and in 2006 the adoption of what is called the Human Rights Policy Guidance for CTED, in which the members of the Counterterrorism Committee, who are of course the members of the Security Council, agreed that we should take into account relevant human rights questions. The emphasis was on the word relevant. It was slow going. There were some members of the committee that did not want us to push too far, but certainly in the terms of the resolution there are questions related to international criminal cooperation, to protection of refugees, to the financing issues, which raise the question of due process, which was referred to before. And so we started to gingerly address those topics in our engagement with states. And part of the argument that was used, I'm talking about sort of the middle period now, is that not only, obviously, is it a matter of states' obligations to respect human rights in their counterterrorism measures. The Security Council finally did make that pronouncement, but it also is a question of effectiveness. And since one of the main objectives of Resolution 1373 is strong international cooperation to bring terrorists to justice, you needed to have good legislation, legislation that wasn't susceptible to abuse, that would promote exchange of information, extradition, and other forms of cooperation rather than vague legislation, etc. So we had a good basis. Torture, of course, was a concern. You can't extradite someone if there's a concern or substantial risk of torture in the requesting country. So the working methods of the Security Council started to change. And then by 2006, that's when the General Assembly adopted this global counterterrorism strategy, which was referred to, which as you know, was a huge step forward, adopted by unanimity, and which certainly went farther than the Security Council resolutions, not only in placing human rights in a very prominent place as one of the four pillars, human rights and rule of law, but also in raising this delicate question of conditions conducive to the spread of terrorism, which was, frankly, radioactive in the years before 2006. There was a lot of tossing about of the term root causes, but many states simply rejected the notion of root causes of terrorism. They said terrorism cannot be justified. But rather remarkably, through some tough negotiations, this document was hammered out, which contains a important paragraph about the conditions conducive to terrorism, which include, for example, violations of human rights and lack of rule of law. It includes socioeconomic marginalization, lack of development, poor governance, unresolved political conflicts, dehumanization of victims of terrorism, and it really opened the door to a much broader paradigm and sort of framework in which to look at the terrorism question. And it's taken some time, but the Security Council now has also taken that on board, which I think is quite remarkable. The Security Council, in its latest resolutions on terrorism, refers not only to the need to respect human rights and rule of law in measures to implement 1373 and later 1624, which is this rather extraordinary resolution about incitement to commit acts of terrorism, but it also calls on states to promote and implement the global strategy of the General Assembly. And most recently, in Resolution 1963 of December 2010, which extended our mandate, the Council in the preamble recognized that terrorism will not be defeated by military force, law enforcement measures, and intelligence operations alone, and that states need to address the conditions conducive to the spread of terrorism, as outlined in Pillar 1 of the strategy. Resolution 1963 also called on us to work with states to develop broad and comprehensive counterterrorism strategies, which include attention to the factors that may lead to terrorism. Now, this was all unprecedented and very sensitive, but I think it reflects, to a large extent, the reform that Anna and Katja and George have been referring to, this notion that the UN should start to approach questions of peace and security with a broader, within a broader context, understanding the interrelatedness of development, security, and human rights, and not just emphasizing the sharp-edged aspect of Chapter 7 of the Charter. I do just want to mention this quote I've always loved from our former Secretary General Kofi Annan in 2003. He said at one conference on terrorism that, quote, while terrorism is an evil with which there can be no compromise, we must use our heads and not our hearts in deciding our response. I think that really nails it, because we have to be sensible about this. And so a lot of the talk that's taking place at the Security Council and in the work of the Counterterrorism Task Force, which supports the implementation of the global strategy, we're talking about drivers of radicalization and what pushes people toward terrorism, while always emphasizing that terrorism is criminal and unjustifiable, but trying to understand and trying to intervene at an early stage precisely for the objective of prevention that my colleagues have been referring to. And so I can tell you that in some recent country visits that I've had the privilege to be a part of, and by the way, in the early days, there was no way the human rights officer was even going to be a part of country visits, but I've had a chance to participate in some recently. Our message has been very much not only that, you know, we don't only look at the law enforcement and legal framework, but we also look at, for example, the goals that have been articulated by the High Commissioner for Human Rights, issues that have been identified such as discrimination, lack of economic opportunity, lack of respect for economic, social, and cultural rights. And so as a Security Council body, we are urging the adoption of broad strategies which take all of these issues into account. And I think it's just a remarkable change in paradigm. I think it's very much consistent with this new reform agenda. There do still remain some questions, which I'm sure Marit is going to answer fully for us in just a few minutes, such as how do we work with the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights? No, these issues are a little sensitive because actually we have a good cooperation with OHCHR in general, but I have to say that some other agencies who are part of the CTITF, UNDP, some of the humanitarian agencies, kind of want to keep counterterrorism at a distance. So the question is, you know, how can we push this new vision of effective counterterrorism that, that promotes rule of law, that promotes development, while not sort of creating problems for our colleagues in the development and humanitarian community. So I'm just going to conclude. You know, I think the answer finally is going to be that we need to, you know, maintain our communication, work on parallel, very closely associated tracks. We do have very different mandates. We can certainly strengthen the work we do. By the way, we just got approval in our little office for a second human rights officer after 6 years, so that's a big development, particularly in these economic times, to get the General Assembly to agree to another staff position. And it wasn't by unanimity that time, I can assure you. But some think tanks have said we should cooperate more effectively with OHCHR. We should, maybe the special rapporteur should be a part of CTED and CTC missions. You know, we still have not gotten to that point. We talk the talk, but we're not walking the walk that's been referred to about integrating human rights and rule of law more effectively in our message. So that's our challenge. Just last thing I want to say, sorry, I have to put this in, is the role of civil society. And George quite properly referred to the both the importance of internal and external actors. And civil society has a huge role to play, and we are experimenting now within our committee, a Security Council committee, on getting better interaction and have actual dialogue with civil society, which I can assure you is not an easy sell necessarily with all members of the Security Council. But as a matter of principle, most members are convinced that effective counterterrorism, in order to identify those drivers of extremism, you have to also talk to civil society and understand, you know, what people in local communities are thinking about the threat that they're living with every day. So that's how things have changed, I think, in the last 10.5 years or so. Thank you.
Thank you, EJ. Marit will give the concluding remarks, so I think we'll let you off the hook for the time being. I would like to open the floor for questions, comments. So who would like to start? Yes, please. But before you ask your question, could you please identify yourself as well?
Yeah, Kim Shepley from Princeton University, and I'm just about completing a book on the effect of 1373 on domestic law around the world, and I guess one of the...
Excuse me, I think we would need to use the microphone.
Kim Shepley from Princeton University. I'm just completing a book on the effects of 1373 on domestic law around the world, and that's a really big challenge. And I guess I'm wondering, as this movement is going forward to try to reform what's happening at the Security Council and in the international framework, how much attention is being paid to undoing what the international framework pushed states to do in the early days? Because there was a lot of pressure to bring in massive anti-terrorism legislation, and at least in a lot of the countries I've been following, it doesn't look like there's a lot of pressure on the ground to pull that stuff back. So I'm wondering if there's now an unrolling kind of, an unraveling or a pulling back or a never mind or you get over it or do something else that's getting pushed out from the international organizations out to the states.
Thank you. Let's take a couple of questions. And then we'll give the panel the possibility to answer. So, no questions? Maybe we need some answers from here. Oh no, there we have one. Good.
Hi, I'm a criminal lawyer from the University of Málaga. I have recently written a book about criminal lawmaking process from a domestic point of view. And I would like to ask, in connection to that, if any of you would have any proposal, specific proposal to reform from an institutional point of view the mechanisms and the way law is made in the UN. I know it's a very difficult and broad question, but I would like to know what are your opinions about it. Thank you very much.
A third question? Yes, here in the front row.
My name is Niklas Schulz from the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights as well, and just had a question mainly to George, but also to the other panelists. With the reform that was brought about last year by adoption of resolutions 1988 and 1989 of the Security Council and the strengthening of the role of the Ombudsperson in the 1267 Sanctions Committee, do you think we have reached enough? Is that human rights compliant now in terms of, and rule of law compliant in terms of due process guarantees? Or if not, what would you like in addition if that's not the case?
To improve mechanisms. So, and regarding the way in which law is made in the United Nations, well, that would take us years of discussions because, as you may well remember, when you study international law, the way in which law is made in the international system is a very different way. So you need to have a consensus as broad, the broadest you can.
But I must admit, looking not least from the project, trends towards greater accountability, whether it's judicial mechanisms or non-judicial mechanisms, increasingly the trends seem to be that the maximum level of due process should be afforded, even in non-judicial mechanisms. I'm an advocate of within those mechanisms of the Ombudsperson, whilst it's fantastic, all of the achievements which have been made to date, I would like to see more of Article 14 of the ICCPR requirements reflected within those mechanisms, mm-hmm. unless there's a very good justification for their non-inclusion. Relating to, as well, just a couple of more general observations on the Ombudsperson role. Clearly this discourse at the moment as to whether or not the precedent of the 1267 sanctions regime should be extended to other sanction regimes as well. And I think there's a key argument to be said that effectively the precedent's been set now. You can't give increased level of due process to one mechanism mm-hmm. and not to another. Mm-hmm. And indeed, I would go further in not simply suggesting that it should be extended to targeted sanctions against any individuals or non-state actors, but also in the instance of state actors, in that whether or not sanctions are targeted or not, if we're deeply concerned, and rightly so, with the human rights of the individual, how much more so we should be in the context of targeted sanctions that can significantly impact upon the economic, social, political rights of potentially millions of people. And one of the recommendations that we've included in this reform agenda report is that in the case of sanctions imposed upon states, should there not be an independent review mechanism for states also to challenge and have reviewed the sanctions which have been imposed upon them, such that there's more than merely diplomatic and political processes in place. In terms of Kim's observation on 1373, absolutely, it was unfortunate that 1566 was 3 years later. In the wake of great legislative activity, and of course one of the issues, not least on the legality principle, some of the overly broad and ambiguous and very unhelpful legislation that's resulted. In terms of where do we go from here, not least, there's much discussion and discourse about the need for effective interstate cooperation, that you need some compatibility between national legislation. Clearly trying to bring increased harmonization at the global level and unravel at that scale, I despite even EJ's optimism, I think is an impossible challenge. But I wonder what might be realistic in terms of states identifying who their key partner states are. For example, it might be within the region. There might be one or two key states for them. And it might be realistic for those states to view their anti-terrorism legislations together to see whether they might at least bring some increased harmonization between these states, rather than looking at the wider regional and international level. I'm sure EJ will have his finger much more in the pulse than I do in that.
But let's first hear George.
Okay, or since you are, okay. First of all, let me say something very quickly at the point that Kim, this is a very good question. And when I was doing, I was looking at some of the reports in the early phases of the 1373 process when the states were submitting their legislation and was supposed to be scrutinized by the committee. Now, as you know, this has passed with the preliminary implementation assessments and so on and so has gone forward. One of the things that really struck me is how much states, and I didn't look at all the states, but I look at about one third of the states, were using that process in order to legitimize whatever legislations they wanted to pass. And you had the schizophrenia in the United Nations system that the Counter-Terrorist Committee, from what we know at least, were not raising any questions about the laws as they were phrased, but other organs of the UN system, like the Human Rights Committee, will say, you know, it's something, the counter-terrorism legislation violates certain fundamental provisions of the International Covenant on Civil. And these were supposed to be both organs of the same organization, the United Nations. And now, I have not followed up to see nowadays, but I doubt, although I don't want to stick my head to it since I haven't done any research to a bit, but I doubt you will have seen much change on that. In fact, a lot of rather unpleasant regimes were kind of very pleased with 1373 because says now we can pass everything and get the imprimatur of the 1373 committee. On the good question that you asked, first of all, I just want to echo, first of all, what Katja said. You need some more Article 14 guarantees in that process. If you read also Kim, although I have to tell you, Katja, I didn't manage to read the whole book, but I read quite a bit of this for this session. And Kim Prost was one of the chapters that I read. She herself says at one point, the ultimate determinant is the Sanctions Committee. After all, the arguments and the reports are presented before her. A very fundamental due process provision is that you cannot have the same people that decide to put you on the list to also adjudicate whether you should continue to be on the list. You know, this is, for me, very, very basic. Now, concerning the 1988 and 1989, I'm glad you asked this question, and at the risk of sounding a little bit too radical here, but there is nothing wrong, I'm an academic after all, you know, I'm entitled to this. I think it is an example, in all honesty, of what some of us call an example of hegemonic international law. Basically, the United States says, we want a separate list so that we can negotiate with the Taliban. Okay, I mean, if you ask me, we can go through all the nice arguments back and forth, but if you scratch the surface, the US wants to negotiate with the Taliban. However, here I think what I would argue is a wonderful opportunity for the convergence between what you might call more instrumentally perspective, let's say the rational perspective, and the normative. Yes, you want it for a negotiating tool, but if you want it to be an effective rule, it must be a legitimate listing and delisting. So even if you want to achieve your own objectives in Afghanistan vis-a-vis the Taliban, you have every incentive to introduce greater legitimacy in the process. That's where I would see a convergence between what you might say an instrumentalist perspective on that, that will say it was done primarily because the US wants to negotiate, but also the normative perspective says if you really want to be effective, you have to make sure that this is done properly to enhance your credibility as a negotiating tool. Okay, I mean, that's my view. Now, concerning the other question, well, that you raised, I don't know, we can talk until tomorrow about that. But one of the things that I will say how we can change a little bit the law, I think those instruments that have such an important lawmaking authority within the United Nations system should be rendered more accountable. I think one way, at least as far as this discussion to start, is those, for in particular the Security Council, which concerns a lot of us here, is that since it is the only instrument that can pass under Chapter 7, the only organ legally binding resolution, is I'm not exactly clear what law applies to the United Nations Security Council. What exactly are the restrictions? What are the human rights obligations of the Security Council? We can all say, well, you know something, it is supposed to act in accordance with the principles of the United Nations system that includes human rights. Okay, but what's next? I think that's where we need to begin the discussion on this issue. But anyway.
A lot of food for thought. Let's
yes.
Hear.
Yeah. Thank you, Anki. Great questions on your very pertinent question about what is taking place to unravel 1373. I should say, first of all, that the Secretary General, in his reform agenda that was announced a few months ago, left no doubt that international terrorism is a major preoccupation of the UN system and of the Secretary General, obviously of the other bodies. There's going to be a review of the global counterterrorism strategy in a few weeks. One has to answer that question, I think, by first asking, do you accept the notion that international terrorism remains a significant threat to international peace and security? And, my personal opinion doesn't really matter on that, but I can assure you that the Security Council and all the other organs and the Secretary General believe that it does. So that is going to continue, at least for some time. It's going to be an emphasis, and part of it is because, obviously of the terrible violence that terrorism does to its victims and to the need to prevent further acts. So that's part of the starting point. But you're right. It can be uncomfortable, believe me, to be situated in a mechanism which is pushing states to adopt tough counterterrorism measures. While at the same time insisting on respect for human rights. And there have been quite a number of laws that have been adopted in haste that were adopted for exactly the reason that George and Anna and Katja mentioned. Now there is some opportunity for reform. I think George is absolutely right to refer to the Human Rights Committee and to the Special Rapporteur. This, I think, is where the partnership with OHCHR is important, about talking about laws that are on the books. Without reference to counterterrorism at all, I would just point out something which some may have seen. The government in Myanmar is reviewing the whole raft of laws that it has had on the books for something like 20 or 30 or 40 years, which have very broad definitions of threats to national security, mm-hmm. and it's undergoing a process of review. Now, I think in that process, the UN should be involved, the human rights mechanisms, the UN Office on Drugs and Crime, ourselves and others. And I think part of the argument we can use now, and we have used it with some pretty tough customers, is, you're not necessarily helping yourself. I mean, I don't want to sound too naive, because authoritarian governments will look for the toughest laws they can get, but there are, I think, some in government who are open to the idea that repressive laws are eventually going to come back and bite them. And, we see major changes in the world. And I think that there's an opportunity, therefore, to push on this notion of conditions conducive, to talk about creating space for democracy, for legitimate political opposition, et cetera. So it's not going to be unraveled, but there is a problem, an immediate problem, as you say, of some laws which are very troublesome. And just on the question of reform on lawmaking processes, and my other colleagues here from the UN, as well as everyone here, has as good or better a perspective on that than I do. You know, at the moment we still have the Security Council such as it is, and there are Security Council reforms, but you know, the Security Council is going to make its decisions. It took a lot of pressure to create this system of the Ombudsperson, and and they were very fortunate to get someone like Kimberly Prost, who has really taken it very seriously and has done her best to create something which does, to at least some extent, incorporate Article 14 protections. But as Katja implies, and we all know, it isn't. You know, it's not, obviously, it's ultimately the members of the committee who will make the decision. So, but I think that, you know, internal reform is a process that's ongoing, and but that's, you know, very difficult. I'm not going to tackle Nicholas's question. It's too tough. Oh, just by the way, someone was just delisted from the 1267 regime like yesterday or something. I just got an email this morning. The European Center for Constitutional Rights and Human Rights, yeah, they succeeded in getting one individual who had been listed forever delisted, and but they, in their press statement, they make the point that if they had not served as counsel and really pushed this case before the U.S. and Italy, which were the two listing countries, this individual would still be under sanctions. And they explain how this person and his family have suffered for the last 8 years under these sanctions.
Okay, thank you. Let's take another round of questions. There was one over there. Can you just wait for the microphone? Thanks.
Thank you. Denise Lifton from the Counter-Terrorism Implementation Task Force. I was interested to hear about the need for the role of civil society and what George said about how the strategy provides a space for interaction between UN and civil society. I'd be interested to know how this space could be further exploited and what would especially be the role of victims of terrorism within this.
Other questions? Yes.
Dorota Gieric, John Jay College Human Rights Center, former Human Rights Director at the United Nations. I have the following question, practically, I think, to all concerned. What's the relationship in the United Nations work? Because there are numerous references to the rule of law and human rights. But at the same time, we have almost in parallel ongoing process within the UN of security sector reform and the rule of law, which are not necessarily the same processes. So we have counter-terrorism, we have security sector reform, we have rule of law. Any kind of comment on the interdependency or to which extent security sector reform is guided by the rule of law and human rights? We're most grateful.
Third question? Are we running out of questions? Shall we consider this the last? Yes.
I'm still Kim Shepley from Princeton. I have a different question about the Security Council, and that is that at least a couple of years ago there were at least some kinds of conversations about trying to figure out mechanisms within the UN system for determining whether the Security Council had acted within its own mandate under the Charter, which is to say a kind of ultra vires review somewhere in the system, and I'm wondering if that's still under consideration anywhere.
Would there be any other questions? And if not, let's take a final round here with the panel. Shall we now start with EJ?
Okay. Thanks, Eike. I'll be very brief. I think other panelists will certainly have a lot to say on this, but to Denise's question, you know, I really think that this is something we have to push. You know, you and I have had this discussion. There has been some progress in giving greater voice to the victims of terrorism. There have been a number of important initiatives at the UN, and in some of our regional consultations, and some of the strategies that we are coming up with, including within the CT, as a member of the CTITF, to counter-radicalization and to, you know, to counter-incitement, et cetera, there's a clear recognition that victims' voices are fundamental to that, and to the extent they are willing, and there are certainly many victims' groups that are willing, they need to be given a voice, in addition, obviously, to other protection and to the right to justice. But it's every step is difficult, and I mean, we had a side event on that included civil society at the 10th anniversary review of the adoption of Resolution 1373. This took place just last September in New York, and it wasn't easy to get agreement on the role of civil society in that event. This was a Security Council event. I think it's different at the GA, and I hope it's different. But again, you know, as the resolution says, terrorism will not be defeated by military, law enforcement, and intelligence alone. You need to get the support of local communities. I think we all know that, and so the challenge. And I think the UN has a great opportunity and potential as a convener to bring together security sectors and civil society groups, maybe to find common ground in making their communities safer. And that goes to your question also. You know, as you well know, I can tell from your experience, it's a long, slow process. There is this sense of dichotomy between SSR and human rights. I think some on the panel know more about that than I do. But I think that another element in, I think, in the Secretary General's reform plan, and certainly in the High Commissioner's agenda for action and priorities, is the question of accountability and oversight of law enforcement and other responsible agencies, and this notion that you simply can't separate the two, that effective law enforcement means, and it means winning the support of the community. And this is where the argument, I think, really can carry some weight. I mean, there are countries in the world today that are facing a serious terrorist threat, and yet, according to polling I have seen, citizens fear the security forces to an extent more than they do the terrorist groups. And that is, you know, it's untenable, it's unacceptable, and it just, it's a sensible argument for us to make that you need security sector reform in order to, you know, make the communities feel safer. And to do that, you have to hear their views. And so that's why, again, going back to Denise's thing, it's important to get civil society and security sector together.
Thanks. George?
Very briefly, just to add to what Ed says in the question that you raised, as you know, there are other international fora as well as treaty that they provide actually for victims of certain violations to be for and their voices to be heard in reparation proceedings and so on and so forth. Concerning victims of terrorism, one problem that I think the human rights community needs to address and put more emphasis on this, because I agree with you, it is very important, is to redress a certain imbalance in the way the human rights discourse has treated counter-terrorism initiatives, because due to the excesses that we saw in the early years of the counter-terrorism effort, there have been much more focus on trying to deal with the excesses of counter-terrorist measures, and rightly so because of all the horrors, but not as much attention was paid to the human rights violation of terrorist activities. In fact, there have been some human rights groups that have been, you know, some actually activists that have been quite vocal about this, and they need to redress a little bit that imbalance and look at the rights of people that have been victimized by terrorists as themselves a human rights issue, because terrorism, after all, is a violation of human rights, as terrorist activities result in very serious human rights violations. So Part of this difficulty here has been, and I'm not, of course, trying to overgeneralize there, but a certain perspective that has not focused as much attention to this issue because it has focused so much on the excesses of counterterrorism and now needs to reorient. In fact, there have been some very big arguments in one prominent human rights organization that led actually to a very big debate within it as to how seriously it was taking the human rights violation commission by terrorist activities. So this is something that more works needs to be done, and there is a clear deficit here that we need to address. Concerning the issue of security sector reform that you read, I don't have much to add to what Ed said. The only thing I would say is that usually, although you going back to the good old adage of talking the talk but not walking the walk, if I say all the papers that I have read in which they say that security sector reform, let's say if you want to reform the military, if you want to reform the police, if you want to reform the intelligence agencies or whatever, this has to be informed by human rights standards and come under the rubric of the rule of law and so on and so forth. If I had a dime for each paper that I have read or a verbal commitment, I would probably be a millionaire by now. Unfortunately, in practice, this has not been, Although my argument will be in this context, Dorota, that if somebody prescribes to a thick conception of the rule of law as opposed to a thin conception of the rule of law, and you and I have discussed that, obviously, this issue needs to be addressed. The Security Council, security sector reform, come under more directly under the rule of law rubric. But more importantly, to see in situations of missions on the ground more seriously, trying to implement security sector reform initiatives that will be informed by this kind of commitment. On the issue. Of the question, actually, yeah, Kim, your question again? There have been, I mean, I don't know, maybe some colleagues that work at the UN, maybe there have been in the past discussions because, let's put it this way, it is not the first time that the issue of to what extent actually the Security Council work, acts ultra vires is not the first time that has been raised. Even before that, the issue came, let me remind you, actually it was a case that related to a terrorist incident. If you look at the case that was brought before the ICJ when the sanctions were imposed on Libya for its failure to extradite the terrorist. And the question come Libya then says, I am not going to extradite the terrorist, I'm going to prosecute them here because the Montreal Convention allows me to do this. And of course the question comes, however, that the United States and the United Kingdom want these people to extradite because obviously they were concerned, and rightly so in a sense, that Libya justice was not exactly conforming to what you might say international civil and political rights principles or whatever else you want to bring. And there was concern, I remember at that time at the United Nations, what will the ICJ say? I mean, they were not sure. Of course, as you know, the case did not go forward in the end, but when it was a discussion about provisional measures, they basically found very convincing. So in a sense, we're heading towards some kind of a serious discussion, but then it was bypassed. So there have been recurring conversations on and off, but unless somebody else knows more, I do not think at the moment there is any particular constituency in the United Nations system that has this as, is focusing on this issue as an issue that should inform actually debate within United Nations organizations, at least to the best of my knowledge. But whenever some kind of a case or whether cases have gone before the European courts, because always the concern behind that is that sooner or later we may have a case in which one of these courts will decide to take directly on this issue as opposed to and what is going to happen next and whether we should preempt this and be prepared. But I don't think any substantive along these lines is going on at the moment at the UN system. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Josh. And now, Katja.
Yes, if I can just make a couple of comments with Denise's point. First, in terms of the role of civil society in terms of informing and shaping part of the debate, and if I can maybe sort of define civil society sort of broadly as external entities to the UN, clearly I think we have a very important role to play. And in fact, even in some of the dialogue we've had in relation to the dissemination of, you know, this project and its findings, is a recurring comment that we've had, which we appreciate, not least we both have practitioner policy backgrounds as well as academic, is those in government and also at the intergovernmental level are having to react to so many things in so many ways at such speed that to be able to, in a sense, to have the luxury to step back and do in-depth substantive analysis is just something that most people don't have. So clearly, in terms of informing the debate, and in a sense, that's why we really do believe, looking at the UN reform agenda, why we gave the current panel its name and wrote a report, is that we passionately believe about being able to form the substance from in-depth work that the governmental, intergovernmental level simply doesn't have the time to do. And of course, one of the benefits as well is that because we're not in the political debate, we've got the luxury of being able to stand back and look quite neutrally how the law is and how it should be. And of course, we recognise the political powers at play as well. In terms of victims of terrorism, we've looked at, we would say there's two victims in a terrorism, counter-terrorism context. There's victims of terrorist attacks, and there's victims of security imperatives, mm-hmm. and both are important. And I remember I was in New York at the time of the last biennial review of the global counter-terrorism strategy, and many felt it was an embarrassment that victims weren't even referred to in the General Assembly resolution. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, externally, looking in, ultimately victims, preventing victims, are at the heart of counter-terrorist responses. And it was politically embarrassing. And certainly I hope it's something that in the next biennial review has been noted and is going to be adequately addressed as well. And just sort of developing on, just making a couple of comments on that, we do look at both type of victims. And in terms of more generally strengthening the rule of law framework, one of the questions we've asked in terms of identified weaknesses is more that can be done in terms of strengthening the framework for victims, asking the question, why is there not an international convention for victims of terrorism? Because when one looks at the national, the regional and international level, including, for example, the 1987 principles, there's no shortage of norms. And one would say that, you know, perhaps it's time that there can be a lot of political rhetoric on the significance of victims, that now's the time for both states and institutions to back that up with normative action and outputs. And certainly that's one of the core recommendations that we make, that there should be serious dialogue, and I'm sure this is happening in different formats, about introducing such a convention.
Okay, briefly, because I'm quite aware of the time. So I had also the opportunity to much criticize the delay of the Security Council in including the protection of human rights as a constraint when countering terrorism in its resolutions. And but the fact is that even if it acted ultra-virus or not, everybody obeyed the Security Council resolution. And I must criticize here the attitude of the European Union, because the members of the European Union many times like to give lessons to others. So they adopted immediately the framework decision on terrorism, which was a reform in, I think, December 2008. So the best goal of that that framework decision was that the members of the European Union were able to not define terrorism, but at least to have an exhaustive list of those crimes related to terrorism. Something that, by the way, we had already in the UN Convention on Financing of Terrorism, so that it wasn't that good, but well, that was the best achievement, which was well sold all over in Europe and outside. When the reform came in 2008, they forgot, in the first version, they forgot completely human rights also. In the second version, they just include, it was funny because they copied down a very good convention by the Council of Europe, the Prevention Convention of 2005, the only one dealing with prevention and dealing with the role of society, civil society, and dealing with the root causes of terrorism, the only one existing nowadays. And they copied down the provisions of that convention except for clauses concerning human rights. And it's not included, just a general reference to human rights in the new framework decision as it was modified in 2008. So the role of civil society, well, that would be a good model to take into account the provisions of, I don't remember exactly, it was Article 11, Article 12 of the Convention, but that speaks about a tolerance, that speaks about the root causes of terrorism, poverty, and the need for helping people in these conditions. And I would remark also the extraordinary role played by the European Court of Human Rights, because through decisions concerning freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and there are quite a few, the court is underlying the need for more tolerance and a peaceful cohabitation with different cultures, different people, different religions. Even though many states are criticizing very very deeply, very strongly the court, saying that the court is going beyond what they accepted in the treaty creating the court in the Statute of the Council of Europe and the European Convention, in the European Convention of Human Rights, so saying that you cannot say that you will go even beyond the Convention Against Torture of the United Nations because you will be more strict than we can be at the international level. So we go again back to the back to future, as Professor Bale said in a moment. The key point is cooperation by states. The Ombudsperson said in the report also, obviously I agree with the suggestion of extending the mechanism and all the proposals we have been talking about here, but the problem is the lack of information by states many times, the way in which they provide that information. So at the end of the day, in international law, the key point is, will a state cooperate as much as it's needed? So that's all. Thank you very much. I had a senior professor in international law who said always, okay, let's talk again about the reform of the United Nations Charter, but why don't we first comply with the Charter? So if we comply with the Charter first, the rest wouldn't appear so important. So thank you.
Thank you, and I think that particularly that last comment really reminded us of the basics in a way. No further final comments from the panel, so then we are actually running out of time. Okay.
We have a reception.
I was just going to say that we can continue because there is a reception afterwards. So please hold on to your question and post it after. Okay, good. So let me hand over to Marit Kohanen-Sharif for concluding remarks.
Thank you very much, Anki, and dear fellow panelists. I'm actually quite humbled and honored to have been invited here and to speak on behalf of the Working Group on Protecting Human Rights While Countering Terrorism of the UN Counter-Terrorism Implementation Task Force, UNCTITF. It is my first week on the job, but So I'm humbled here because we have many members of the working group here and who have participated in the discussion, who know much more. But at the same time, I think it's important for the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights to be present and to make its mark, since we chair this working group and since we have been together with our colleagues pushing the agenda and pushing the envelope. And I'm particularly humbled also because I've learned a lot today. I was in this position of working in the New York office about 10 years ago, and it's incredible how much we have advanced on the discourse in terms of human rights, countering terrorism, and rule of law. It's really actually startling to me. And so whilst I will offer some concluding remarks, I also wanted to make one or two comments along the way, in the context of the discussions we've had today. But before that, I really want to thank George in particular and his team for inviting us, for keeping the links going, and for being so involved, and for ensuring that UN practitioners and the academic world meets from time to time to have a reality check on each other's work and to exchange a little bit, because sometimes we can also be in our own, very much in our own little worlds, and we don't learn from each other enough. And I want to congratulate, obviously, Katja and Anna for this incredible work. It was shown to me today, and simply by its size and its volume, it impressed me. But now that I've looked at it a little bit more closely, I think that its depth, and again the combination of practical and academic, will go a long way and serve the audience it is intended to. And then this panel comes at a very good time. We've spoken about its timeliness because we are in the midst of the UN reform effort in terms of counterterrorism, in terms of rule of law, security sector reform that were referred to earlier, but also overall in UN general, UN system reform. And one thing that we haven't spoken to, but that I think explains quite a few of the contradictions we might find sometimes in the context of the UN system, is that when we speak broadly of UN system reform, we need to remember that there are different types of organs in that collective that we speak of. So we speak of intergovernmental organs like the Security Council and the General Assembly that constitute essentially of member states. They're political bodies that have something to say on human rights and counterterrorism and the rule of law, and essentially their decisions will be informed by political considerations. So it is clear that what they say might not at all be in accordance with what expert UN expert bodies say on the same topics. And when I say expert bodies, that being Human Rights Committee, other treaty bodies, or the Special Rapporteur. So we need to bear that in mind, that each of these actors has a different role to play in the UN reform and in implementing the global strategy and the plan of action, and they should play a different role, each of them, because that reflects also maybe the global world currently. And then there's the third actor, also we speak of it, we sort of encompass it all in the UN system, but that is the UN Secretariat, its programs, agencies like the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, UNHCR, UNDP, and others. We are fundamentally those who uphold the norms and principles of the United Nations, but at the same time we serve these intergovernmental bodies. So we find ourselves inherently in a contradictory role when we have to implement a certain global strategy. And so now when we talk about how can we move forward, how can we review the current reform agenda, we need to attribute distinct roles to these distinct parts of the United Nations system, not put them all together. Because that will inherently create, I think, tensions, and then one might say, well, why does the Human Rights Committee say something different than the General Assembly or the Security Council? Well, it's very clear, and so they should, because they play these different roles. And so that comes also to Denise's question, how can we better associate civil society and others, possibly victims, to this process? Well, I think each part of the UN system has a different way of associating them, and somehow it might be easier. It's easier to approach victims to the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights than to the Security Council, clearly. But we need to be aware of the differences that these particular bodies, by virtue of their composition, play. One thing also that I think has come through here, and it's extremely important, is that we speak about rule of law, we speak about human rights, and I heard the argument that we should not let human rights over-dominate either, because there are many other aspects of rule of law that need to be taken into account. But fundamentally, it comes down to the fact that rule of law is about processes and institutions, more so than human rights law, humanitarian law, refugee law, is about the content that these processes and institutions will be applying. Because one can easily uphold rule of law when countering terrorism, but it might be completely contradictory to human rights if the law we're upholding is in itself contradictory to human rights. And so I think that that's quite important for us to bear in mind, because we sometimes intermingle rule of law, human rights, and we use them exchangeably, but it's not, in practice, it is not exchangeable. They are complementary and they need to be used together. And that's why, of course, coming from the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, I don't think there's ever an overemphasis on human rights in any of our processes. We're still far lacking behind. Then we go to the same point of, that also Dorota made earlier, how is rule of law, security sector reform related to this counterterrorism reform agenda currently? Well, from my point of view, the one common thread is human rights again. And that's it. Because if we apply equal the principles and standards of human rights, equality, non-discrimination, and so forth across all these sectors, we end up with what is the essence that binds us. And that is that we need to make sure that these processes cannot be sustainable unless we have accountability, unless we have obligations, clearly identified obligations, and clearly identified duty bearers, rights holders, etc. And so I think that that, at least conceptually, is quite clear to me. But also, I think that when we speak of operationalization of making these things practical, of applying the concepts, and I just come from having been our regional representative in Central Africa, Central African sub-region, all I can say is that there is a demand on the UN system to operationalize these concepts. We have now, not all concepts are clarified, granted, but we've gone quite far in conceptualization. But when the UN resident coordinator, essentially often dependent on UNDP, is faced with a government who says, listen, I need to reform my laws, and be it they're going in a positive way or negative way, the UN resident coordinator needs to be able to respond to that very practically. So applying these concepts through either training, through technical advice, legal advice, what have you. And I think that's where we go to Ije's question that, how can we bring UNDP closer? They want to shy away from it. Well, the reality on the ground is that their people are requested by governments who they also serve to step in and to help. And so UNHCR will find itself in the same situation, I think, as well. And so therefore, I think that's the best argument to enlarge in the partnership, and I'm all ready with you to make that argument. But in any case, before I conclude, I was also supposed to say a few words about what this working group does in terms of precisely making maybe a little bit more practical the concepts that we have discussed now. And you will find more in the SG's report that has also just been recently issued on the implementation of the strategy. But let me mention, because it might be of interest to you, that the working group in which the office chairs with its partners is developing a series of basic human rights reference guides, which should be providing clear and practical guidance on human rights compliant counterterrorism measures. So we could speak in areas such as stopping and searching, security infrastructure, principle of legality, etc., prescription of organizations. So these are intended to be a series of very practical tools that can be used on the ground by governments and others, and that can be used in training that we also do. Members of the working group, the different organizations we engage in, as I said, technical assistance in terms of law reform, but also in training law enforcement officials, judges, prosecutors, defense lawyers, and others, which we consider a very, very important part, both prevention, but also addressing ongoing violations. We've had a series of regional workshops on issues such as fair trial, due process guarantees, and so forth. We had one in Southeast Asia, for the Southeast Asian region, Middle East and North America region, and we will have some for Europe and South Asia in 2012 and 2013. And the idea behind these kind of workshops is also that we should develop a set of universally applicable guidelines which are based on human rights, the rule of law, and best practices, national, regional, and international level. So we'll go from the international, we go at regional, which are very important developments, and essentially focus at national level. And then I'm really glad that the issue of victims came up, even though later in the debate, but obviously from a human rights point of view, this working group is also extremely committed to try to bring about some kind of accountability framework for victims of terrorism or victims of counterterrorism strategies that do not respect human rights. It goes both ways. We had a Secretary General's symposium in 2008 that also reaffirmed the critical position of victims in defining counterterrorist strategies. And so I think we need to go back to that and see what can we do a little bit more concretely from there. Finally, I think the obvious, but it's only through respect for human rights and the rule of law, compliant counterterrorism measures that states can succeed in fulfilling their obligations to prevent terrorism. But let's also not forget that we've gone quite far. in terms of concepts and possibly even standards. We need to identify the gaps, but more so we need to move towards implementation. And I think that that means implementation means also addressing this very important area that EJ spoke about, the conditions conducive to respect for human rights. So that goes back to the root causes, because without that, there'll be no prevention. And I mean, maybe that's where an office like the High Commissioner for Human Rights or UNDP or other organs of the United Nations can be brought in even more actively. Nevertheless, obviously, also we also said, never can we justify or excuse terrorism, even when human rights violations might have led to the marginalization and discrimination of certain groups. And so therefore, prevention of terrorism becomes our joint responsibility, especially towards the victims. So that's it. That's my time. And thank you very much for having the office on the panel. Thanks.
Thank you, Marit. And the final word will go to George.
Yeah. Thank you. This brings us to the end of this event and to the end of the academic year for the Center for International Human Rights. So I would like, first of all, on behalf of the center, to thank again all the participants to this panel, Anna, Katja, Anki, Ed, and Marit, the CTITF Working Group for its co-sponsorship, again, as well as the Center on Terrorism, Oxford University Press, and the Venable Foundation. They all made this event possible. And last but not least, since it is the end of the year, I want to acknowledge the staff of our center, who throughout the year has worked very diligently to make things happen in this place. And so I would like, if they don't mind, to stand up to be recognized.